the boy.
Since the Athenians intend to deliberate on some question, are you getting up to giving advice?
Something you know or something you
don't know? And is it because the question is one of which your knowledge is better than yours?
Okay.
And where did we leave off?
We leave off way back here on somewhere around 116B.
Yeah.
Better.
been moved.
All right, just for a moment, right? Could we just go back together? On those matters that you happen to know, then, you're a good counselor. You would say the same, wouldn't you?
Yes.
On the matters which you know.
Yeah.
All right, you could be a good counselor, couldn't you? Mm-hmm. And of the things which you know, you must have learned them from others or found out from yourself. Is it possible that you could ever have learned or discovered anything if you had not been willing either to learn or find out for yourself?
No, it's not.
Prior condition for this is, right? You must have been willing to learn. In order to have learned something, you must have been willing to learn or to find out for yourself. That follow?
Yes.
Yes, in general.
Yes.
Say, would you have been willing to seek out or learn things which you thought you knew? You would say.
No.
Huh.
Why bother?
Why bother if you already knew them? Right? Key conclusion? Then, obviously, then, there was a time when you did not consider yourself to know that which you they now know.
Yeah.
Agree?
Mm-hmm.
That follows? All follows? I suspect that this is the heart where it keeps going back to what it's for us. It lays the strategy for much of that develops. There was a time when you did not consider yourself to know that which you may now know. Or if you do profess to know something now, then you must have been in a situation previously where you had to find out what it was you wanted to know or didn't know. Two ways in which you can learn something is learning from others or find out for yourself. And so therefore you must have had to have gone through this study. But if you do profess to know something now, you must have passed through a prior study of what?
Not knowing.
Of not knowing. So he's going to find out whether or not there was a time when
he...
And if you can't think of a time when he didn't know...
He doesn't know.
Right? Then he what?
Then he doesn't know.
Then he doesn't know. Why?
Because you have to not know and then learn about it.
Right.
To know.
Right. Right. Right, so that's key, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Never a time when he didn't know.
Or didn't think he did.
Didn't think he knew.
Didn't think.
Pardon? There was never a time when he didn't think he knew.
Yeah, there was never a time he didn't think. Therefore?
He never realized that he didn't know.
Therefore, he could never have
passed through the state of not knowing.
Yeah. Or he has to claim for what he knows innate knowledge.
Yeah.
Or he would have said that. You say we were on what page in the Thomas last trip? Pardon? 56? Well, I certainly hope that still remains between 55 and 57.
Okay, thank you.
My job.
page are you on of the job?
119 is the Stephanus number on the side.
What page do you have the same job?
I think so, I'm not sure.
Okay, yeah, this is 748. Is it 119?
Good, good.
Boy, that's a lot.
What is it?
Well, I don't know if these numbers correspond.
They do.
117 is over. On the right-hand side on page 749.
Did you say that?
That's where you had it open.
Why don't we pick it up from now by the gods, Socrates, I really do not know what I am saying.
Wait, this is fine.
But I seem to be in an utterly absurd state. But when you ask me questions, I am at one moment of one opinion, and at the next of another. And I think the question we posed last time, is that equivalent to saying I do not know?
Oh, yeah.
That's 116E.
116E.
Yeah, the math. Greek phrase. The math.
Okay, because that's the state of mind. Right? I'd like to hear other translations of it. Right? Got a jowl or low?
By heaven, Socrates. But by heaven, Socrates, I do not even know what I am saying. I feel altogether in such a strange state. For from moment to moment, I change my view under your questioning.
Can we go to Tater again?
I solemnly declare, Socrates, that I do not know what I'm saying. Verily, I am in a strange state, for when you put questions to me, I am of different minds in successive instances.
Here's one. But by the gods, O Socrates, I do not know, I at least do not know, nor what I'm saying. Because it's the word ud in there, which is a nor. There's two things negated.
You're translating that straight from the Greek, huh?
Okay. Yeah, it's okay. Always a ego game. Same verb that was used for to know further back, one of which your knowledge is better than theirs. Same verb. And he's saying that he doesn't know. Nor what to say, or nor how to speak. Okay, okay.
Keep going.
Huh?
Yes, please continue. The meat is yet to come.
But a technos, without any art or skill, aoika. Atropos. I don't know the rest of it.
Okay.
But my point was that it looks like the translation was only picking up one thing. I don't know what to say. But I think it's I don't know what to say, and I also don't know. I don't know, not even what to say.
Yeah, that doesn't describe the state of mind. See, it's a state of mind the guy is in. That's most significant for us.
Yeah.
Now by the gods, Socrates, I really do not know, but I seem to be in an utterly absurd state. If the word is strange, it's much better.
It's atropos, or strange.
Yeah, it would be much better, because I would say that's an unknown state for him.
Strange seems to be in a...
of another. That's what's strange to him.
Mm-hmm. He's got opinions going around it. They would say if he only had one, then he'd still think he would know it. He would know. Because I'm really in a baffling state of mind. I am at one moment of one opinion, at the next another.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the state of mind.
That's the state of mind.
That's what he's going to inquire about.
That's midwife in the Indian. Midwife in the Indian.
Wait. No, but I'm alive. So if we can get some readers to play, right? We'll explore the strange or absurd state of mind.
Yeah.
Strange.
Yeah.
It's a state of mind.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's what a scout says, I'm in a strange state.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Unaccustomed would be, you know, that aspect of the rut. Absurd is nice. But strange gives the custom aspect, which would be better for him.
Yeah.
How spot. Yeah. Okay, we'd like to play.
All right.
Yeah, good, great. We need, you want to play some? Yeah.
Sure.
We need a Al, Al spot. What do you say, Paul?
I'll try.
Sock comes back.
And you are unaware, my friend, what this feeling is?
I am quite.
The feeling is more.
Pathema. Pathema.
What?
It's problematic.
Yeah. Pathema may not just be feeling.
Is that often pathos?
Experience.
Right? Experience.
What do you do with that?
I figure it's related to. I thought it was related to Pascha, but I don't know. Suffer experience. I haven't. I did want to look it up. I don't know.
The feeling doesn't quite catch state of mind.
No. And it's very unlikely for you to use that language. Isn't it?
Uh-huh.
Has no cognitive element. Like you feel hot, you feel cold.
Yeah.
You don't have a feeling that's a feeling. That's a, you know, that's a kind of a modern use of sloppy effect. Alcibiades comes back with the immortal words.
I am quite.
I am quite.
Well, you suppose that if someone should ask you whether you have two eyes or three, two hands or four, or anything else of that sort, you would answer differently from moment to moment, or always the same thing?
I begin to have misgivings about myself, but I still don't think I should make the same answer.
And the reason would be because you know?
I think so.
Then if you involuntarily give contradictory answers, clearly it must be about things of which you are ignorant.
Very unclear.
And you say you are bewildered in answering about just and unjust, noble and base, evil and good, expedient and inexpedient. Now is it not obvious that the bewilderment is caused by your ignorance of these things?
I agree.
Then is it the case that when a man does not know a thing, he must needs be bewildered in spirit regarding that thing?
Yes, of course.
Well, now you know in what way you can ascend to heaven?
On my word, not I.
Is that too a kind of question about which your judgment is bewildered?
No, indeed.
Do you know the answer, or shall I state it?
State it.
It is, my friend, that while not knowing the matter, you do not suppose that you know it?
Here again, how do you mean?
Do you share in seeing for yourself? Are you bewildered about the kind of thing that you do not know and are aware of not knowing? For instance, you know, I suppose that you do not know about the preparation of a tasty dish?
Quite so.
Then do you think for yourself how you are to prepare it and get bewildered, or do you entrust it to the person who knows?
I do the latter.
And what if you should be on a ship at sea? Would you think whether the tiller should be moved inwards or outwards? And in your ignorance, bewilder yourself, or would you entrust it to the helmsman and be quiet?
I would leave it to him.
So, you are not bewildered about what you do, do not know, so long as you know that you do not know.
It seems I am not.
Then do you note that mistakes in action also are due to this ignorance of thinking one knows when one does not?
Here again, how do you mean?
We set about acting, I suppose, when we think we know what we are doing.
Yes.
But when people think they do not know, I suppose they hand it over to others?
To be sure.
And so that kind of ignorant person makes no mistakes in life, but they entrust such matters to others?
Yes.
Who then are those who make mistakes? For I take it they cannot be those who know.
No, indeed.
But since it is neither those who know nor those of the ignorant who know that they do not know, the only people left, I think, are those who do not know, but think they do?
Yes, only those.
Then this ignorance is a cause of evils, and is the discreditable sort of stupidity?
Yes.
And when it is about the greatest matters, it is most injurious and base?
By far.
Well then, can you mention any greater things than the just, the noble, the good, and the expedient?
No, indeed.
And it is about these, you say, that you are bewildered?
Yes.
If you are bewildered, is it not clear from what has gone before that you are not only ignorant of the greatest things, but while not knowing them, you think that you do?
I am afraid so.
Alack then, Alcibiades, for the plight you are in. I shrink indeed from giving it a name, but still, as we are alone, let me speak out. You are wedded to stupidity, my fine friend, of the vilest kind. You are impeached of this by your own words, out of your own mouth, and this, it seems, is why you dash into politics before you have been educated. And you are not alone in this plight, but you share it with most of those who manage our city's affairs, except just a few, and perhaps your guardian, Pericles.
Yes, you know Socrates.
Can we get another two translations of that? Because that's a loaded. That's what we're calling
it. It's for the people of voters. Have you read this?
Here is the challenge.
Which one is it?
I have a balance.
This is the bewildering library?
Yeah, this translation is bewildering, just to say.
It's also wanders.
Wandering.
Yeah, wandering.
Wandering.
Like planets wander.
Wavering,
yeah,
wandering.
Planet mind. All the words are used for wandering. And what he's calling stupidity is amathia, which is a negation of learning. Unlearnedness. And he's got a mixture in between Hades and Oresai.
Yeah, well, can you conclude about that letter? Are you going somewhere at this point with it?
It's very rich with words. Words for knowing.
Yeah.
Seeing.
Well, come back to it.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, let's get another translation. Okay? Yeah, let's look at the Java.
And now see what has happened to you, Alcibiades. I've heard it.
Here, have a seat, girl.
Look at that. We have to break for Steve. Look at that. I mean, the Steve Lincoln is not even up. God.
We only have one book.
Oh, no. No, no, not thank you.
Why don't you let each of them hold one of the books?
Yeah.
Okay. If you can concentrate.
Yeah.
Okay, Java.
How are we doing?
Announce me what has happened to you, Alcibiades. I hardly like to speak of your evil case.
Your
evil case. But as we are alone, I will. My good friend, you are wedded to ignorance of the most disgraceful kind, and of this you are convinced, not by me, but out of your own mouth and by your own argument. Wherefore also you rush into politics before you are educated. Neither is your case to be deemed singular, for I might say the same of almost all our statesmen, with the exception, perhaps, of your guardian Pericles.
Bless me, Alcibiades, what a state you are in.
Really?
One which I fear even to name. Yet as we are alone, it must be said, you are living, my good sir, in the most extreme kind of ignorance, as our own discussion convicts you, and you convict yourself. And it is because of this that you are rushing into politics before you have been taught. Nor are you the only one who is in the state, for it is that of the majority of those who manage the affairs of our city, with the exception, perhaps, of your guardian, Pericles, and a few others.
Pierre, to go back to your question about the feeling, all these words for plight and case in here are the same, related to the same word.
Plight?
To plight. So rather than feeling, it would be more like plight or what you're experiencing. Or she used the state for what that one means.
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm.
The other interesting thing is that when it says you are wedded to stupidity in the Greek, that term is synoikes, which is compounded of the word for house or household or household, and sun, which would mean like, it's almost on the level of your family, that kind of relationship. You're together, your household is together with ignorance. And the way he was described as being in the earliest passage was he saw himself as being of a family and of relationships were of the most genteel. So this is like on the level of saying, on the appearance, you may have the greatest gentility in your family, but in truth, your household is of the most ignorant.
The guy's very close, you know. I mean, he never embarrasses anybody. You know, that's what I like about the guy. Always cautious about coming to conclusions.
Very subtle. Yeah.
Very subtle, man, isn't it? He would never cause anyone to be cautious.
Isn't there a word for missing the mark, amartia, which is sin? Well, that's what he's saying over here about, that he types that in 117e, just before 118. Socrates said that about which, what do they sin about? What do they, how does Ross have it? If you read that as sin, that about which they don't know. Because if you read that as sin, it ties in with this about evil. It starts talking about evil and ignorance.
worker of evil, kako, ergo. Remember what we were doing last time? You said we could take a section, a unit, and we could look for the connections, and then we could see the way the particular groupings or couplings threw out, and we could talk about the gaps between them. The way we started, now by the god Socrates, now by the gods, right? That's Alcibiades. So we can call Alcibiades the first, Socrates, right? So we'll call that unit one. And we can proceed all the way to this point, which I take that to be with the, I call it Pericles. All the way to the section where we just read Pericles. There's a whole series of these. As you compare them with what we did last week, what would you say about their connection, their sequence of connection? Height, distance?
We're closer.
Closer,
yeah.
Right?
Answering without the benefit, without distraction.
Okay. Hypothesis. I create a hypothesis. When does Alcibiades, let's say, stay close to the development of the questions? If this is an example of it.
When he doesn't know?
When he doesn't know. Right? When he's discussing his the state of mind that he's in, whatever state of mind that is in, right? When he's exploring that state of mind that he's presently in, Socrates then can proceed in the dialogue, and all of those couplets or those units are tight, aren't they? All right? Now, watch after Pericles, what happens.
Yeah, that's what the next speech is answering.
It's like a digression.
It's answers.
But, like, what would you say happened in this final paragraph with Pericles? Let's read it. That's what we need, another reader. All right, now, in order to play this, Paul,
yes.
Why don't you read it as if you were acting it out,
okay,
in a living scene, and address your remark to me.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Yes, you know, Socrates.
No. Here.
Yes, you know, Pierre. They say he did not get his wisdom independently.
No, pardon me, the beginning, when I'm 56, before we started.
56.
Now by the god Socrates. Right where we started out this evening. What was that, 116?
E. By heavens, Pierre, I do not even know what I am saying. I feel altogether in such a strange state. For moment to moment, I change my view under your questioning.
Okay, now, would you please read your response to Paul? All right, address him as Paul.
Paul, are you not aware of the nature of this perplexity, my friend?
I am quite.
Do you suppose that if someone were to ask you whether you have two eyes or three or two hands or four or any of that sort, you would then be of different mind in successive instance?
All right, now, keep that dialogue in mind. Go to the paragraph that we just ended with and address that to Paul. And Paul, you tell us what it's like to receive those words.
Sure, right. Please.
Well, the paragraph we concluded with on Pericles. What number is that?
118.
118B?
Let's see.
Oh, BC.
Yeah, those words,
yeah. Yeah. They got it delivered.
Right,
Paul. Yeah, keep the dialogue in mind. Go ahead.
And now see what has happened to you, Paul. I hardly like to speak of your evil case, but as we are alone, I will. My good friend, you are wedded to ignorance of the most disgraceful kind, and of this you are convinced, not by me, but by your own words, your own mouth, and by your own argument, words of fear. Wherefore also you rush into politics before you are educated. Neither is your case to be deemed singular, for I might say the same of almost all our statesmen, with the exception perhaps of your guardian Pericles.
What's that like, getting that one?
Well, it's a big put down.
That's it?
I respond
in the next paragraph.
Your whole family.
Yes, Carol. Yes, Carol.
Yes, you know, Carol, they say he did not get his wisdom independently, but consorted with many wise men, such as Pythocleides and Anaxagoras. And now, old as he is, he still confers with Damon for that very purpose.
What did he do?
Lost.
He took off on the Pericles
took the heat off
and just left everything else that had gone before.
Discoursing about wisdom.
He picked the only exception in his family. They're all dumb.
That's his family.
Yeah.
But possible exception of Pericles. Yes?
Talking about Pericles.
Talking about Pericles.
That reminds me of a story about Pericles. I think a story about Pericles. So here we have a gap, right?
Yeah.
And now we want to see what Sock does with it, because would you not agree that was a rather interesting and straightforward conclusion? Personally,
very personally.
She's probably held spell down by the information.
Yeah.
Very good. But did you ever know a man wise in anything who was unable to impart his particular wisdom? For example, he who taught you letters was not only wise, but he made you and any others whom he liked wise.
Yes.
And you, whom he taught, can do the same?
Yes.
And in like manner, the harper and gymnastic master?
Certainly.
When a person is unable to impart knowledge to another, he thereby gives an excellent proof of his own understanding of any matter.
I agree.
Well, Paul, did Pericles make anyone wise? Did he begin by making his sons wise?
But what if the two sons of Pericles were simpletons, Socrates?
Well, but did he make your brother Clinias wise?
But why should you mention Clinias? A madman.
I mean, he's dragging out the guy's family. Let's review your family.
But who is it that's making the comments about
the Yeah.
He calls the Pericles son simpleton, and the Jowett simpleton, and the man in the Quintus. But if Quintus is a madman, and the two sons of Pericles are simpletons, what reason can be given why he neglects you and lets you be as you are?
He's polite. He's a nice kind of a guy to have in a party. All right? Let's get another translator. Got a Lobby? Who's got a Lobby? Go ahead, read that paragraph a little bit.
Well, if Clinius is mad and the two sons of Pericles were simpletons, what reason are we to assign in your case for his allowing you to be in your present condition?
Yeah. Since therefore Clinius is a madman and the sons of Pericles were fools, can we in your own case assign any reasons for his allowing you to remain in this condition? You're in a terrible state. Why did he allow you to remain in your condition? Maybe he was silly and mad too. Good heavens. Go ahead.
I believe I am myself to blame and not attending.
Yes, I believe that I am not, that I am to blame for not listening to him.
Not turning my noose toward him is the cause.
Do you have a qualifier?
What?
Here it's, I suppose I myself am to blame for not paying attention to it.
Ego boimai, I suppose. It's not a particle. It's not like ego gay, but it's just I think.
But it's set off by comma, so it's meant to be.
What, Barbara?
I was just saying it's set off by comma. I think. I was just not meant to just put it in indirect discourse.
She misses the prosecon to noose, the current holding the noose toward, or directing her attention to. I need to direct my attention to.
Okay, sure.
Wait a minute, this answer is rather strange, actually. In the sense that he says, all these guys are fools and madmen. Why, how come you're not? It's not like that
research. Is that what you're
answering? Yeah. So it says here, since therefore Clinius is a madman, the sons of Pericles were fools, can we, in your own case, assign any reason for his allowing you to remain in this condition? That's this one. What condition? The condition of the... what is the condition?
What is it?
Where did they go? He allowed you to say it, but so that I'm to blame for not paying attention to that. There's something
Sounds like
he's a
martyr
then.
Not the madman.
Allow that blaming of oneself. I mean,
person attending. That's how I understand it. There'd be some kind of interaction between the two, since they both would be learning.
How could he keep them there? If he says he didn't pay attention or direct his news to them.
So far, there's no proof that anybody learned from somebody.
It's a condition for learning.
Well, it doesn't seem like it's the same situation as when he was taught by Viet as he was with letters. And yet he was able to attend, pay attention there. So it's not that he can't pay attention.
I mean, it's not that he doesn't have attention.
That's true.
Right, he's got it.
Right.
Not like his brother's mad, he may not be able to organize enough attention to direct it anyway.
Right. Or a fool, he's not maybe able to distinguish.
Yeah, quite true, but you're going in the direction of a sacrifice.
Right. Well, sacrifice means that he blames himself for not having learned it, rather than possibly his teacher maybe not being a teacher.
Yeah, perhaps. Want to read the next paragraph?
Sure. But mention any of the other Athenians, or of the forum, either a slave or a free man, who's indebted to his association with Pericles to become wiser than he was. I can tell you, Epidaurus, son of Callidus, who have become wise through associating with Zeno, and who have both paid him 100 minae and become wise and famous.
Well, does it look like he had the ability?
Pericles?
Yeah,
it does. So it looks like Alcibiades was the same.
Yeah. So, like, strangers to his father can learn from him, but his children could not.
Strangers learn from Zeno.
I thought nobody learned from Pericles.
They learned from Zeno.
So
nobody learned from Pericles.
No, Pericles. The proof for Pericles' knowledge is can't be made. He hasn't made anybody wrong.
Yeah. He was engaged.
He's taking the life raft. Pericles, that Alcibiades is hanging on. And sinking it.
Oh, he said, just like I can tell you about these guys who got wise from Zeno, tell me a few people that got wise from Pericles.
Yeah. You can't tell anyone either.
It's a public argument.
He gives a few
examples.
I think that's the rest of the Pericles spent his time teaching in the Athenian people.
Where do you deal with word other in that sentence?
Other Athenians? Yeah. Besides
Zeno. Well, other
Athenians.
No. Oh,
it's one
to mention.
Clinius and
Malleus. That's what I was
saying. What about Socrates? Is he in the association of he could be referring to himself as one that's grown wiser in society
of
Pericles.
Where does it say anyone's grown wiser?
No.
It doesn't.
The other mighty part.
What would it do to the sentence if you took out others? But mention any Athenian or foreigner, slave or free, who is indebted to his associate in Pericles for becoming wiser than he was.
It would only destroy the transition from the idea above, which is that it's Clinius and the two simpleton sons, their opinions. It says, well, so are some other opinions.
Yeah. But doesn't that therefore indicate that there was at least one other person who was indebted to his association of Pericles for becoming wise at any
way. Or that the wisdom of Pericles is foolishness.
That would be one conclusion. And that was. Right, but that would be an irony. That would be an irony he's doing there.
Yeah.
But in any case, does the other presuppose someone else?
I think so.
Who got involved in some association?
Yeah, because it could have been left out.
Where? I don't see.
Then became wiser.
That other refers to other than someone mentioned before.
That's what makes it an irony. But he could have said it without the other in there.
Yeah. If you buy that it's referring back to Plinius and the two syllables.
Yeah.
Couldn't it just refer back to the interchange before that when he says, I believe I myself should like he's saying that he could have made me wise. But I
uh-huh.
didn't intend to.
Oh, I think that's even better.
But tell me of any other Athenian could that go down.
There it is.
Yeah, because he asked what
is explicitly to explain he's in that sense.
He's giving him something there.
Yeah. Possibility.
What?
The possibility of wisdom with his heart.
He's good learning.
Yeah. Someone else. Give me someone else. Give me another person.
Yeah, you didn't pay attention, but who did?
Because he said, what's the cause? And refuses to put the cause of this ignorance on, or the stake that he's in, and refuses to put it on the faculty. Takes it on himself. And gives him that. The rest is rather all embracing. Wouldn't be anybody in town left out.
You think he takes it on himself?
He says, I'm the cause.
No, I'm the cause because I didn't listen to Pericles.
Yeah.
It doesn't say I'm taking it on myself.
Well, the question is, what is the cause? He says, I'm the cause.
He's not exploring the problem within the Pharisees and teacher direction.
Right.
He's not exploring the problem in that statement, but whether or not it can be taught or whether Pericles teaches or can teach it.
He's granting it.
Yeah, he's granting it. He's not exploring the real.
That
yeah.
He may truly know anything
right, which
he
is
does.
Which is the idea. That's,
but
it
should be done. So it's either ironic or sort of a granting, temporary granting. It's either granting Alcibiades other than you, since you appear to be wise, you can do other than you, who else has been made wise? And that says it would be a granting him.
I beg your pardon. Alcibiades does not claim to be wise as a woman from
In that his problem is that he thinks he knows when he doesn't.
No, I mean, in this particular interchange, the issue seems to be whether Pericles, the teacher, and the Alcibiades.
That's why I would go with the first idea that it's an ironic statement. I can't see any other way to go either. It's granting him wisdom, temporarily granting him, yeah, sure, you're wise, Alcibiades, who else do you make wise? Or it's an ironic statement or something other.
I would say that is, if I don't understand that, I see that effect well. I think he's directly telling that he's not wise and he's in a terribly ignorant state. I don't see where Socrates ever gets in that.
Mm-hmm.
Not in this passage, anyway. Which text do you?
No, I meant like a temporary granting, like a
really?
Sarcastic granting.
I want to see the word tell us.
Well, I don't really want to hold that position, so I have some more
sarcasm. It's an attempt to be saying, I love to see it.
I think it's ironic, myself.
Even before that, I like to see it.
I don't want to go through it, the task of doing that.
That paragraph, I think, is ironic too. Structures itself into an analogy divided by a word that divides the word Oscar
So we just go with the truth. Yeah.
Sure.
And you know me through the doors. Right.
Black
did, white. Is there anybody that stands to Pericles as Pythagoras stands to Zeno? Looks like a challenge. So.
This in Socrates on page 61 at 118b, very clearly making the exception to Pericles.
Yes, very clearly.
Oh, yeah, Pericles himself is the most wise.
He's not in that plight. He's not in that plight.
No.
He doesn't think he knows, but he doesn't know, perhaps.
No, perhaps. And a few others as well.
Yeah. Perhaps. And perhaps your guardian.
The question then is, who may be included in the word other? Since it's I think it's accepted now that it does admit of others.
Uh-huh. It could be an opposition. If not yourself, then what other?
It could be an opposition.
Wasn't that if not yourself, then?
Or it could equally be Socrates. It could be any. It could be someone else.
Would have to be included in.
Yeah.
But he's one of the other Athenians other than the ones mentioned.
No, why is he asking this fellow then who this fellow made wise? If he himself is a prime. Well, I don't know.
What did Socrates learn in Pericles?
Well, that's the position that is a possibility that's been looked for. Yeah, included. What the heck? The whole Athenian nation, as Steve said, was in the politics.
When you're saying...
He made everybody wise. Wholly other, if you include all other, right, it's not just Socrates, other people, take what Steve says, he taught the Athenians, he was a public manager.
Yeah.
He made everybody, except for the two simpletons, I mean, the simpletons of the poor society.
Couldn't see his own nose.
Well, can there be a difference between those who, in that state of mind that Pericles was in,
did not pass it on? I thought they were going towards that he can't pass it on. There are people who were in that state, who were not in the other state, but no one was taught by Pericles.
You'd agree it's a better state than all the others. And in that respect, he possesses something.
Yeah. And he's around white men.
And the question is, if he does possess something like that, is one of the conditions of his possession of it that he should be able to pass it on to another? Mm-hmm. But surely it's a good proof that those who know any subject, the test would be whether able to produce another who knows it also. That's the Dharma successor idea.
Right.
And there it is. So if we grant that, which is the force of the argument, let's see who we get it to. Well, it's going further because Alcibiades is offering that even in his present age, he's still intimate with those who know and are still pursuing that quest. Already associating with many wise men. So even in his present age, he's intimate with them. For this very reason. It's because of that passage, isn't it, that he's pushing, all right, given let's assume that the man is wise, how certain things should follow from him. Mm-hmm. Or the connection wouldn't be sound, right? There would be a gap again. Does that establish, is Alcibiades trying to establish his Pericles' credentials?
And the process.
Sure.
Yeah. So you get it from somebody.
Yeah. Okay, let's do that. Let's push it. Let's see where it goes.
If wise, you can be a cause.
Pardon?
If you're wise, you can be a cause of wisdom in others.
Yeah.
And he's not the cause of wisdom in anybody.
Where okay, can you push on it?
Yes.
Well,
have we concluded
what
therapy
passed on you? Thoroughly
explored, anyway.
Well, that's where we're at.
Oh,
okay. That's where we're at. That's the story.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
Therefore, Alcibiades goes back.
Well, upon my word, I cannot.
Well, and in reference to your own case, do you mean to remain as you are, or are you, or will you take some pains about yourself?
We must put our heads together, Carol. And indeed, as soon as you speak, I take the point and agree. For the men who manage the city's affairs, apart from a few, do strike me as uneducated.
What is the inference?
That if they were educated, I suppose anyone who undertook to contend against them would have to get some knowledge and practice first, as he would for a match of athletes. But now, seeing that these men have gone in for politics as amateurs, what need is there for me to practice and have the trouble of learning? For I am sure that my natural powers alone will give me an easy victory.
Well done, Paul.
Natural pilot.
There is no need for the raft. There's no need for anything. I'll tell you, Socrates. Since I'm dealing with a bunch of nothings, a man with one eye can be king.
My natural.
Would that condition, how can we then quickly again, I am to blame for not paying attention to him? I mean, he's not really blaming himself. Maybe he holds his other position.
Well, when he talks to Socrates, he switches his position.
Not supposed to see, though.
Very quick insight.
He's not going to stay with blame too long.
Suddenly it's natural too.
So then he couldn't find it.
I'm a teacher, so it's natural.
You can only eat humble pie so long.
What I like about this paragraph on the top of 63. So all along they're talking about the fact that if someone lives and someone's going to have to study from them, they're going to have to learn from them, they're going to have to pass what one man knows to another. So at the bottom of 62, Socrates says, well, what are you going to do in your shape? Are you going to remain in your present plight? Or are you going to take some care for yourself? So Alcibiades goes back and he says, let's consult about it together.
Yeah.
Like, what does that mean?
Let
us consult about it together.
We're equal.
Yeah.
Let's you and I sit down over a beer and we'll talk about it.
Yeah.
Don't expect me to.
Yeah.
Call you.
No, that's politics. Right?
I don't really need to.
That's politics.
I indeed, right? And indeed, I understand what you mean. And agree with you. I know what you mean. I finally got it. I know what you mean.
Yeah,
I agree with you.
Oh, wait a minute, yeah.
Right. I'm getting the drift of what you're really saying. I get it. Yeah, back on that paragraph, way back there where you were praising Alcibiades. Let's see, didn't you say Pericles was the only exception? Well, if he's not the exception, then all of those guys are dopes.
You know, what he's saying, he's talking about me.
Yeah.
Talking about all those dopey
dopes. Yeah. Right? For it seems to me that those who manage the affairs of the city are, with few exceptions, quite uneducated. Right? You don't jump back a couple of pages. Right?
Yeah. Right?
The first that reference to...
It's the same way today.
To parent words. Nor are you the only one in the state. For it is that of the majority of those who manage the affairs of our city, with the exception, perhaps, of your garden Pericles and a few others. So Pericles drops out and he says, oh, now I see what you mean. They're all uneducated. Well, if that's true, then I can level with you, Socrates.
I
mean,
he thinks his only help is him. Look at your own, it's not through his association with others.
Yeah. Right? So, look here.
But it must be natural.
At least he's honest.
So, would you agree, here we found a gap. What did Socrates do through this? What did they do?
Close it.
They knocked out Pericles. So that's where the dialogue really kind of goes from here to here. Mm-hmm. That exception is gone. Right? Is that nice? So his only way out of appearing respectful was the raft, as Rod called it, right? The raft of Pericles. And he just lost it. I mean, they both gave it up. I said, okay, that's out. Well, should we take a look at the next section?
Well, we didn't actually finish that one because Sock had a response.
Okay, did you do it first?
My dear Paul, what a sentiment. And how unworthy of your noble form and your high estate.
What is your meaning now, Socrates? What is the connection? Oh, Carol.
I'm grieved when I think of our mutual love.
What?
Why? At your fancying that the contest on which you are entering is with people here.
Well, but with whom is it to be?
Is that a question which the magnanimous soul should ask?
That's true. How do you mean? Is not my contest with these men?
Suppose, Paul, that you were going to steer a ship into action. Would you only aim at being the best pilot on board? Would you not, while acknowledging that you must possess this degree of excellence, rather look to your antagonist, and not, as you are now doing, to your fellow combatants? You ought to be so far above these latter that they will not even dare to be your rivals. And being regarded by you as inferior, will do battle for you against the enemy. This is the kind of superiority which you must establish over them, if you mean to accomplish any noble action, really worthy of yourself and of the state.
Well, I do mean to. Why I do mean to.
Verily, then, you have good reason to be satisfied. If you are better than the soldiers, and you need not, when you are their superior and have your thoughts and actions fixed upon them, look away to the generals of the enemy.
Yeah.
Verily then, you have good reason to be satisfied if you are better than the soldiers, and you need not, when you are their superior and have your thoughts and actions fixed upon them, look away to the general.
That is a tough way to put that.
Of whom are you speaking now, Carol?
Why, Paul, Surely you know that our city goes to war now and then with the Lacedaemonians and with the great king.
That is true.
And if you meant to be the ruler of this city, would you not be right in considering that the Lacedaemonian and Persian king were your true rivals?
That sounds like the truth.
Oh, no, my friend, I'm quite wrong. And I think that you ought rather to turn your attention to Midius, the quail breeder, and others like him who manage our politics, in whom, as the women would remark, you may still see the slaves' cut of hair cropping out in their minds, as well as on their pates. And they come with their barbarous lingo to flatter us and not to rule us. For these, I say, you should look. And then you need not trouble yourself about your own fitness to contend in such a noble arena. There is no reason why you should either learn what has to be learned or practice what has to be practiced, and only when thoroughly prepared enter on a political career.
Why, soft white Carol, I believe you are right, though I think neither the Spartan generals nor the Persian king are at all different from other people.
But my dear friend Paul, you consider what you say.
In regard to what?
In the first place, would you be more likely to take care of yourself if you are in a wholesome fear and dread of them, or if you are not?
Clearly, if I thought them terrible.
And do you think that you will sustain any injury if you take care of yourself?
By no means. Rather that I should get much benefit.
And this is one very important respect in which that notion of yours is bad.
True.
Consider that what you say is probably false.
How so?
Let me ask you whether better natures are likely to be found in noble races or not in noble races.
Clearly, noble races
are not those who are well-born and well-bred most likely to be perfect in virtue?
That must be so.
Then let us compare our antecedents with those of Lacedaemonian and Persian kings. Are they inferior to us in descent? Have we not heard that the former are sprung from Heracles? And the latter from Achaemenes, and that the race of Heracles and the race of Achaemenes go back to Perseus, son of Zeus?
Yes, and mine, Socrates, to Eurysaces, and that of Eurysaces to Zeus.
And mine, noble Alcibiades, to Daedalus, and he to. For all that, we are far inferior to them. For they are descended from Zeus through a line of kings, either kings of Argos or Lacedaemon, or kings of Persia, a country which the descendants of Achaemenes have always possessed, besides being at various times sovereigns of Asia, as they are now. Whereas we and our fathers were but private persons. How ridiculous would you be thought if you were to make a display of your ancestors of Salamis, the island of Eurysaces, or Aegean, the habitation of the still more ancient Aegeus, before our Artaxerxes, son of Xerxes. You should consider how inferior we are to them both in the derivation of our birth and in other particulars. Did you never observe how great is the prophecy of the Spartan kings? And their wives are the guardianship of the Ephori, who are public officers and watch over them in order to preserve as far as possible the purity of the Heracleitic blood. Still greater is the difference among the Persians, for no one entertains the suspicion that the father of a prince of Persia can be anyone but a king. Such is the awe which invests the person of the queen, that any other god is needless. And when their heir of the kingdom is born, all the subjects of the king feast, and the day of his birth is, forever afterwards, kept as a holiday and time of sacrifice by all Asia. Whereas, when you and I were born, as the comic poets say, the neighbors hardly knew of the important event. After the birth of the royal child, he is tended, not by a good-for-nothing woman nurse, but by the best of the royal eunuchs, who are charged with the care of him, and especially with the fashioning and right formation of his limbs, in order that he may be as shapely as possible, which, being their calling, they are held in great honor. And when the young prince is 7 years old, he is put upon a horse and taken to the riding master, and begins to go out hunting. And at 14 years of age, he is handed over to the royal schoolmasters, as they are termed. These are four chosen men, reputed to be the best among the Persians of a certain age. And one of them is the wisest, another the justest, the third the most temperate, the fourth the most valiant. The first instructs him in the... The giant is... of Zoroaster, the son of Oromachus, which is the worship of the gods, and teaches him also the duties of his royal office. The second, who is the justice, teaches him always to speak the truth. The third, or most temperate, forbids him to allow any pleasure to be lord over him, that he may be accustomed to be a free man and king indeed, lord of himself, first, and not a slave. The most valiant trains him to be bold and fearless, telling him that if he fears, he is to deem himself a slave. Whereas Pericles gave you, Alcibiades, for a tutor, Zopyrus, the Thracian, a slave of his who has passed all other work. I might enlarge on the nurture and education of your rival, but that would be tedious. And what I have said is a sufficient sample of what remains to be said. I have only to remark, by way of contrast, that no one cares about your birth or nurture or education, or, I may say, about that of any other Athenian, unless he has a lover who looks after him. And if you cast an eye on the wealth, the luxury, the garments with their flowing trains, the anointings of myrrh, the multitudes of attendants, and all the other bravery of the Persians, you will be ashamed when you discern your own inferiority. Or if you look at the temperance and orderliness and ease and grace and magnanimity and courage and endurance and love of toil and desire of glory and ambition of the Lacedaemonians, in all these respects, you will see that you are but a child in comparison of them. Even in the matter of wealth, if you value yourself upon that, I must reveal to you how you stand. I must reveal to you how you stand. For if you form an estimate of the wealth of the Lacedaemonians, you will see that our possessions fall short of theirs, for no one here can compete with them, either in the extent and fertility of their own and the Athenian territory, or in the number of their slaves, and especially of the Helots, or of their horses, or of the animals which feed in the Athenian pastures. But I have said enough of this. And as to gold and silver, there is more of them in Macedonia than in all the rest of Hellas. For during many generations, gold has been always flowing to them from the whole Hellenic world, and often from the barbarians also, and never going out, as in the fable of Aesop, the fox said to the lion, "The prints of the feet of those going in are distinct enough." But whoever
saw... What a game.
Whoever saw the trace of money going out and therefore you may safely infer that the inhabitants are the richest of the Hellenes in gold and silver, and that their kings are the richest of them. For they have a larger share of these things, and they have also a tribute paid to them, which is very considerable. Yet the Spartan wealth, though great in comparison of the wealth of the other Hellenes, is as nothing in comparison with that of the Persians and their kings. Why I have been informed by a credible person who went up to the king at Susa, that he passed through a large tract of excellent land, extending for nearly a day's journey, which the people of the country call the Queen's Girdle, and another, which they called her Vale, and several other fair and fertile districts, which were reserved for the adornment of the queen and are named after her several habiliments. Now,
you want to talk about your family wealth?
Yeah, right.
He's
trying. I can see his jaw dropping. Now, I cannot help thinking to myself, what if someone were to say to Amestris, the wife of Xerxes and mother of Artaxerxes, and say to her, "There is a certain Dinomache whose whole wardrobe is not worth 50 mina money, and that will be more than the value. And she has a son who is possessed of a 300-acre patch in Archaea, and he has a mind to go to war with your son. Would she not wonder to what this Paul trusts for success in the conflict? He must rely, she would say to herself, upon his training and wisdom. These are the things which Hellenes value. And if she heard that the Saul is making an attempt, is not as yet 20 years old, and is wholly uneducated, and when his lover tells him that he ought to get education and training first, and then go and fight the king, he refuses, and says that he is well enough as he is. Would she not be amazed and ask, on what then does the youth rely? And if we reply, he relies on his beauty and stature and birth and mental endowments, she would think that we were mad, Paul, when she compared the advantages which you possess with those of her own people.
You're just like your brother.
And I believe that even Mantido, the daughter of Leodices, the wife of Archidamus and the mother of Aegis, all of whom were kings, would have the same feeling if, in your present uneducated state, you were to turn your thoughts against her son. She too would be equally astonished. But how disgraceful that we should not have as high a notion of what is required in us as our enemies' wives and mothers have of the qualities which are required in their assailants.
That is amazing.
Oh, my friend, be persuaded by me, and hear the Delphian inscription, "Know thyself." Not the men whom you think, but these kings are our rivals, and we can only overcome them by pains and skill. And if you fail in the required qualities, you will fail also in becoming renowned among Hellenes and barbarians, which you seem to desire, more than any other man ever desired anything.
Well, then, what are the pains I must take, Carol? Can you enlighten me? For I must say your words are remarkable, like the truth.
Mark, remarkable.
Still only like the truth.
Says what you see,
saying like.
Someone says, I entirely believe you. But what are the sort of things that you're requiring? Can you tell me?
What
is this thing which must be cultivated inside the young girl? Can you explain to me? For most assuredly, what you say seems to be true.
Well, that qualifier all the time is so significant for the sense of it.
Yes, I can.
Now, this is a stretch that goes through about 10 pages, but it goes pretty fast. So
yes, I can. But we must take counsel together concerning the matter in which both of us may be most improved. For what I am telling you of the necessity of education applies to myself as well as to you. And there is only one point in which I have an advantage over you.
What is that?
I have a guardian who is better and wiser than your guardian, carefully.
Who is he?
God. Paul, who up to this day has not allowed me to converse with you. And he inspires in me the faith that I am especially designed to bring you to honor.
You are jesting, Carol.
Perhaps. At any rate, I am right in saying that all men greatly need pains and care, and you and I above all men.
As to me, you are not wrong.
And certainly not about myself.
Then what can we do?
There must be no hesitation or cowardice, my friend.
No, for that would indeed be unseemly, Carol.
No, indeed. We ought to take counsel together, for we do not wish to be, for do we not wish to be as good as possible?
Yes.
Mine has, we do. And what sort of virtue?
Clearly, that wish is the aim of good men.
Who are in what?
Clearly.
No, excuse me. Who are good in what?
Clearly, good in the management of affairs.
And what sort of affairs? Especially in affairs?
No.
You mean that about them we should have recourse to horsemen?
Yes.
Well, naval affairs.
No.
You mean that we should have recourse to sailors about them?
Yes.
Then what affairs, and who do them?
Of a Athenian gentleman.
And when you speak of gentlemen, do you mean the wise or the unwise?
The wise, just as the intelligent.
And the man is good in respect of that in which he is wise?
Yes.
And evil in respect of that in which he is unwise?
Of course.
The shoemaker, for example, is wise in respect of the making of shoes?
Certainly.
Then he is good in that.
Good.
But in respect to the making of garments, is he unwise?
Yes.
Then in that, he is bad?
Yes.
Then upon this view of the matter, the same man is good and also bad?
Apparently.
But would you say that the good are the same as the bad?
No, indeed.
Then who do you call the good?
I mean those who are able to rule the city.
Not surely over horses.
Horses. No.
But over men.
Yes.
When they are sick?
No.
Or on a voyage?
I say no.
Or reaping the harvest?
No.
When they are doing something or nothing?
Doing something, I say.
I wish that you would explain to me what the something is.
Well, men who do business with each other and make use of one another, as is the way of life in our cities.
That's the key transition to a nice, long argument. It goes fast, but that's the key.
Do you want to keep going then?
Yeah.
Okay. Those with whom you are speaking are ruling over men who are using the services of other men?
Yes.
Are they ruling over the signal men who give the time to the rowers?
No, no.
That would be the office of the pilot.
Yes.
But perhaps you mean they rule over flute players who lead the singers and use the services of the dancers.
No, no.
That would be the business of the teacher of the chorus.
To be sure.
Then what is the meaning of being able to rule over men who use other men?
I mean ruling over men in the city who share in it as fellow citizens and do business with each other.
And what sort of an art is this? Suppose that I ask you again, just as I did just now, what art makes men know how to rule over their fellow sailors?
The pilots.
How would you answer? The pilots? That's what you said, right? And if I may recur to another old instance, what art enables them to rule over their fellow singers?
That which you just mentioned, the chorus teachers.
And what do you call the art of fellow citizens?
Good counsel, I should say, Carol.
And is the art of the pilot evil counsel?
No, no.
But good counsel.
So I should think for the preservation of his passengers.
True. And what is the aim of that good counsel of which you speak?
For the better management and preservation of the city.
And what is that of which the absence of presence improves and preserves the order of the city? Suppose you were to ask me, what is that of which the presence or absence improves or preserves the order of the body? I should reply, the presence of health and the absence of disease. Would you say the same?
Yes.
And if you were to ask me the same question about the eyes, I should reply in the same way, the presence of sight and the absence of blindness. Or about the ears, I should reply that they were improved and were in better case when deafness was absent and hearing was present in them.
Correct.
And what would you say of the state? What is that by the presence or absence of which the state is improved and better managed and ordered?
In my mind, Carol, friendship with one another will be there, while hatred and faction will be absent.
And do you mean by friendship agreement or disagreement?
Agreement.
What art makes cities agree about numbers?
Arithmetic.
And private individuals?
Yes.
Or what art makes each individual agree with himself?
Yes.
And what art makes each of us agree with himself about the comparative length of the span and of the cubit? But does not the art measure?
Of course.
Individuals are agreed with one another about this, the state, equally?
Yes.
And the same holds of the balance?
It is.
But what is the other agreement of which you speak, and about what? What art can give that agreement? And does that which gives it to the state give it also to the individual, so as to make him consistent with himself and with another?
Most likely.
But what is the nature of the agreement? Answer, and think not.
I suppose I mean the friendship and agreement that you find when a father and a mother love their son, and between brother and brother, and husband and wife.
But can a man, Paul, agree with a woman about the spinning of wool which she understands?
Oh, yeah.
Nor has he any need for spinning as a female accomplishment.
Yes.
And would a woman agree with a man about the science of arms which she has never learned?
Oh, yeah.
And suppose that the use of arms would be regarded by you as a male accomplishment.
I would.
Then upon your view, women and men have two sorts of knowledge?
Of course.
Then in their knowledge, there is no agreement of women and men.
No.
Nor can there be friendship if friendship is agreement.
Apparently not.
Then women are not loved by men when they do their own work.
Seems not.
Nor men by women when they do their own work?
No.
Nor are states well administered when individuals do their own work?
I think they are, Carol.
What? Paul, do you mean to say that states are well administered when friendship is absent, the presence of which, as we were saying, alone secures the good order?
But it seems to me that friendship arises among men just on that account, that each of the two parties does its own business.
That was not what you were saying before. What do you mean now by affirming that friendship exists when there is no agreement? How can there be agreement about matters which the one party knows and of which the other party is ignorant?
Impossible.
And when individuals are doing their own work, are they doing what is just or unjust?
That is just. What is just, of course.
And when individuals do what is just in the state, is there no friendship among them?
Again, I think that must be so, Phil.
Then what do you mean by this friendship or agreement about which we must be wise and discreet in order that we may be good men? I cannot make out where it exists, or among whom. According to you, the same persons may sometimes have it and sometimes not.
Well, by heaven's care, I do not even know what I mean myself. I fear that for some time past, I have lived unawares in a very disgraceful condition.
Right?
Yeah.
So he brought him to another state of mind, didn't he?
Uh-huh.
Now, by the gods, Socrates, I myself do not know what I mean. But it looks as if I have for some time been unconsciously in a most disgraceful state. But it looks as if I have.
Can
you save himself?
I do not know what I am saying.
He can't get out of that.
How does the loaf? What does the loaf do to that?
I fear that for some time I have not lived. I have lived in a very, disgraceful condition. I fear that. Well, by heaven's Socrates, I do not even know what I mean myself, and I fear that for some time past I have lived unawares in a very disgraceful condition.
That's a new state of mind, isn't it?
Right?
So you can go back and see how it got there. So we started with a state of mind, and now we're in a and that's where a good place to break. And if you lost it, right? You lost the thread. Right? Try to go back and see where you lost it. There are a couple of gaps.